The subject is slightly different. We normally deal with interferometry technique to get the high angular resolution. Now the problem comes, the subject is new. Say for example, this is a telescope. It was built in India, basically in our institute in 80s. Now, it's a 2.3 meter telescope. It's not a very big one, but you see that it has got a Cassegrain focus, prime focus, even fiber optics bundle, Coudé focus as well. Now the mirror is sitting inside this cell and it's a huge dome. There's a enclosure here for guiding. Now when it is about 40 feet above the ground level in the midst of forest, when the air, cool air is flowing in the observatory, certain entrapment, certain places, the air is getting trapped and it creates a turbulence. Even inside this cell, if you put your finger, you will find the temperature difference about 1.5 degrees, and every half degree means 1 arc second seeing creates problem. Now the cool air is flowing down and the hot air, which was in the ground floor, first floor, second floor, and this is in third floor, and they start moving up and down and it creates more turbulent cell. Now what is happening? If we starlight above the turbulent cell, it's a plane wave front. Once it passes through the cells, these are all eddies it forms, and then it disturbs the plane wave front, becomes distorted. Now, if you have a small telescope, the size of this equal to this kind of eddies, then you get a diffraction limit image. Now, if the telescope size is bigger, you get this kind of, because these are all getting interference each other. Some are in phase, some are out of phase. And then you get a small blobs like this, and then it forms speckle. Now, if you take a point source, which cannot be resolved by this telescope, and if you take series of images giving exposure of say 10 milliseconds, because that is the lifetime of these eddies, it dies and forms. Lifetime is about 10 milliseconds. Then if you take series of frames and then do autocorrelation, you get this kind of image, and this is the speckle the size, that is the diffraction limit of this telescope. The 2 meter telescope will have 50 milliarcsecond. So the 50 milliarcsecond is this one, the half of that, and half of this base is the scene. That is normally the, if the sky is good, atmosphere is laminar flow, if it flows, then you get about say 1 arc second image. That 1 arc second will show you here. But then between 1 arc second and the diffraction limit, you will not get any information because it gets overexposed. Now what is happening is that how it forms. See, in 60s, holography was more important subjects, and then at the time they found out once the laser light is flashing through that plate, they found out some kind of grainy structures, and these grainy structures are nothing but the some kind of speckles. It's called laser speckles, and their formation was explained by the addition of coherent vibrations having random phases as transmitted through a scattering plate. At the telescope focal plane, the speckle patterns are also the same thing, caused by the fluctuating bumpiness of the optical wave front received from a star entering a telescope aperture after crossing the turbulent atmosphere. Now the large telescope produces star images containing more speckles because it goes by lambda by R naught to the power 6/5. So the sizes are, this is lambda by R naught whole square. So if the lambda by d whole square, and then it becomes d by r naught, d is the size of the mirror, and r is the size of the eddies. So d by r whole square means suppose if you have a 1 meter telescope, you will have 100 speckles. If you have 2 meter telescope, you will have 400 speckles. If you have 10 meter telescope like Keck, you will get about 10,000 speckles. Now, to correct that, there are two ways. One is offline, and another one is online. Offline is the is called speckle interferometry. Now, the Singh is not only the atmospheric problem. It has got even the mirror problem. See, the thermal distortion of primary and secondary mirrors when they get heated up, dissipation of heat by the secondary, rise in temperature at the primary cell, at focal point causing temperature gradient close to the detector. Now the conventional image, that is those who are giving overexposed, but anything more than 10 milliseconds is called overexposed. And normally the conventional astronomers, we are all unconventional astronomers, but those who are conventional astronomers, they try to give exposure of say 10 seconds, 20 seconds. What is happening is that every image, say for example, I is the image at the focal point, O is the object, and S is the point spread function of the telescope, atmosphere and everything together. So these two are getting convolved. So we get the convolved image. Now, if you average them at the image level, then it becomes overexposed. Now, say, look at this. These are the speckles. And if you have a telescope of say 2 meter class or 5 meter class, and if you have a strong eyepiece, you can visually see that these kind of speckles are there. That this one. You see, it forms very fast and dies also fast. But if we give overexposed, the same image will look like a blob here. So you cannot make out that whether this is a the binary star or single star or is a star is getting resolved, because all information will be lost here. Now, how to get the high resolution image? Now, if you have a camera system, you have to magnify it because the size of the speckle is 50 milliarc second. In order to record those speckles, you have to have at least 2 to 3 pixel size area. So you have to magnify the image, and then you have to put a either a pair of Ressler prism to correct the dispersion, or you have to have a narrowband filter, and then the image you have to go to the detector here. Now, how to guide them? You have to have a micro hole here, and for example, this is about 350 micron hole, which gives you about 2.5 second image. Now, if you guide a star, that star you have to guide in such a way that object star should pass through this hole. If it till then, it will reflect here and then goes to the de-imaging lens, goes to the ICCD. So to see that from here, you have to guide in such a way the star passes through this hole. The microscope objective will magnify it, and then start recording it by giving exposure of say 10 milliseconds each, and collect series of frames, and then you do the you have to take even the reference star, unresolved star, and then you calculate. It will give you the this kind of a autocorrelation image. This is the center one, and this particular object is nothing but a closed binary star. And then since it is autocorrelated image, so you'll have a, the companion will have a either side 180 degree out of phase, we'll get these two structure and you can make out, it's a binary. Now, this is the speckle interferometry calculation. Now, how to do the image processing? That image processing came sometime in 74 and later 1977. The other one came 1970, that is the Lebery, he first took his camera to Balamar telescope, and then he invented this technique. Then later on, people started measuring the image phase information. So there are many algorithms are there, like Knox-Thompson, Fine-Off, then maximum entropy, then blind iterative deconvolution. We tried in our institute, apart from building the speckle camera, we tried bispectrum technique. There's a triple correlation. So you shift the image and then you take the conjugate. So it becomes a four-dimensional calculation. So in those days, in 90s, the computation was so heavy that even a single frame of 128 by 128 used to take hours to analyze. And then for example, this is a simulated binary. And then we got a bispectrum. Bispectrum definition is nothing but a triple correlation of a binary system. So it's a bispectrum. And then you do the autocorrelation of this. No, sorry, Fourier transform of the triple correlation is bispectrum. And you do the autocorrelation, you get a out of 180 degree. There are some same binaries showing in six spots. And then you have to find out which is the one actual binary, whether this one or this one or this one. Then you calculate the phase calculation and then take some kind of a area. Then you get your exact binary system here like this. So now this is a laboratory simulation. Now the moment you get your atmospheric turbulence fitted image, the problem comes in twofold. One is that the telescope structure, then the atmospheric problem, then the calculation becomes huge. So the Weigelt and Grove, they found out a butterfly nebulae, and then a beautiful image, the red rectangle. They have found beautiful image here. Then this is a speckle image. After doing bispectrum analysis, they found out it's a cluster of stars. And then what we did is one of my students, I asked him to develop the program much easier way, that is called Radon transformation based. And he did the calculation, and it's nothing but a projection based calculation. So the same image he has taken in the image space itself, we don't need to do Fourier transform. And then one dimensional projection, depending on how many projections you give, say 45 degree, 90 degree, and 125 degree. So for example, this is a simulated galaxy, and he has done 10 projections. He is showing this much of clarity. He did 150 projections. He gets almost the same the galaxy pattern. And then we found out, we have done the, because we developed both direct bispectrum as well as tomographic code. We found out that tomographic code is much faster. The 200 frames, for direct, it used to take 1 hour, 21 minutes. And tomographic code, it used to take 15 minutes. And if you take, there is 180 projections. If you give 18 projections, it used to take 2 minutes. And then maximum size limit, 200 by 200 pixels. Whereas tomography, you can do 10 to the power 4 by 10 to the power 4 pixels. So all those calculations, we used MATLAB 32-bit program. And now the actual speckle of the data is a single frame. After projection of, this is a bispectrum speckle frame projection used in tomographic, this one. We got the binary system, which exactly it is matching with the blind decomposition calculation we have, what we have done earlier. It was showing the separation 0.21 arc second. And magnitude ratio also showed 1.5. Now these are, of course, the we use some kind of a simulation, that co-phased image, speckle frame, reconstructed image with tomography. And we do the extended object also. And we found out that pattern is coming almost same. These are all simulated one. Then we took a 6-star speckle frame. We found out this is a direct bispectrum and this is a tomographic image. We found out that tomographic speckle masking is giving us better result. Now the in 90s, the adaptive optics system came. It is nothing but the same atmospheric turbulence. You correct it online. That is the pattern which is giving disturbance, the wavefront pattern. You calculate the other way, the anti this one, and then you will get a plain wavefront. For that, you require a deformational mirror, and it has to run very fast at the speed of the lifetime or freezing time of the speckle. And then you correct it. In that process, you have a wavefront sensor, calculate the R naught size. Depending on that, you have to run deformational mirror, and then corrected wavefront will come here. You can see that when AO is off, this kind of structure you get. When it is on, very sharp image is coming, and this is a faint object, and this is a tight binary system is here. This is the speckle. Now, we did in the laboratory, these are our laboratory setup we did at that time. It's nothing but you have a collimated lens. This is a face screen we created. We put aperture mask. We got speckles here. When we did processing our tomographic system, we found out that binary system is here. Now, this galactic center of the Milky Way galaxy, that you know that recently two persons were given Nobel Prize because they identified the supermassive black hole. But at the time, one of my friends, Bedding, he used a ESO 3.6 meter telescope at La Silla, and at the galactic bulge, not the Sagittarius A star, but it did not include, but he used the adaptive optic system. In 1997, he got this sharp image. Now the 1974, the thinking came that how big telescope one can make. In those days, like bigger telescope was 5 meter telescope. Leverie thought that we can have like a radio interferometer. We can have a radio interferometer type that two telescopes should be in two places, but then how to combine the beam? Because this telescope, each telescope will give you a number of speckles. So now one of these speckles from one telescope should merge with the other speckle of other telescope, and then you will get fringes within the telescope, and then you process them with autocorrelation, you will get a autocorrelated image. These are all, see, there is time short, what kind of science one can do this. So that is another subject we can discuss. There is a limitations, what are the limitations are there. So this is the first experiment which he tried 1974, putting two telescopes, one here, another one. This is the central lab where he combined the beam. Later on, he moved to Kalan Observatory. And he's a person at that time in 70s, his photograph you can see. So the 1988, this kind of two big telescope, each one is 1.5 meter primary mirror. Is essentially the collimated beam is coming to the central lab. And then here you have a rooftop prism and then takes a beam through eye. You have to see that fringes. Then you shift this prism. It will go to via grating to the detector, and then you start grabbing them. This is the central lab. This is a achromatic doublet where beam comes and then freezes. This is the kind of that fringe pattern one can use. And you have to collect about, with that particular incident, we collected about 300,000 frames. And then you do the autocorrelation. And every time as it comes to the closer, you have to shift the telescope to different till you get the resolved positions. So as it gets resolved, you will get this kind of pattern. Now afterwards, many people started building telescope. This is a Sydney University stellar interferometer, which is a forerunner of VLTI interferometer. Now this one, VLTI, and this is the Keck telescope. This is a binocular telescope, where it will have a plenty of UV coverage.
Yeah, Professor, then, you have 2 minutes.
Fine. And after that, about a dozen interferometer came, out of which about two or three are still working. And this is the kind of algorithm we developed to calculate the orbits. And interferometric data, if you take, you can get a very nice fitting data. And these are the things we have developed, and all those things are available, you know, in my book. And now this is the interesting one that recently Gay and Ganzel, there are two different groups. One used VLTI, other one used Keck Observatory Telescope. And look at that particular area. There, the several stars are orbiting. See that S12, S1. And then all those calculations they did several years. Data they calculated, and then they found that all these stars are moving around this particular object, which they infer that this is a supermassive black hole. Now the latest thing came that whether we should be happy with the two telescopes or three telescopes, or we should have a like a, this kind of reach where we can put plenty of small telescopes and then put a gondola here, get the beam here, and then get the fringes. And this is, of course, this is called hypertelescope. And this is the image was taken with a single mirror, but gondola was about 100 meter high. And they took a Vega, that is Alpha Lyra, which was overhead at Nice Observatory. They took a image. And we did calculations that if we have a more number of apertures, like say 96 apertures, how many UV coverage one can have. So we did calculation that the AGN, Polon and Azon, that this kind of image one can detect. And if you have an exosolar planet, we can even detect the, with that many telescopes, we can detect the exosolar planet around which moves around the parent star. And all those information you will get in these books, which I have written between 2007 to 2015. There are four books are there, and all the calculations, the how to use two telescopes, how to use multi-telescopes, how to use the single telescopes, high resolution image showing what kind of detectors are required. And these are the theoretical work that waves and oscillations, that how it behaves right from electromagnetic waves to alpha waves and solar waves, gravitational waves, etc. I think there I can